It's a darkened room with no window, no light. In the foreground of which is a naked woman lying on her back on a bed of twigs and leaves. One leg is drawn up, her sex is quite visible and is open. But it's one of the things that you can't quite get out of your head.
Marcel didn't talk about it, and my mother didn't talk about it. I didn't even know. I knew there was a body involved, but I didn't know anything about the rest of it. Not a thing.
No, he never told me. I never permitted to penetrate the two or three rooms that composed the studio. And I was curious to know what in hell he was doing.
The heavy wooden doors in this gloomy room are part of a work of art. It's the final work of one of the most influential artists of the 20th century. The scene behind it has puzzled and intrigued public and critics alike for almost 30 years. Until recently, nobody has been able to understand its full significance, or the personal drama that inspired this modern masterpiece. This is the extraordinary story of the mysterious artist who created it, Marcel Duchamp.
I'd almost make it my business sometimes to meet him on the staircase, to actually say hello to him. But he was not open. He was not too receptive. He had his preoccupations, reclusive in a sense. On the bottom of this little building is an ash can, in which he deposited all the garbage. And I was curious to know what in hell he was doing, because there were piles of metals, glass, all kinds of gadgets of all sorts of descriptions, put in the ash can. And I'd take out it piece by piece to examine it. And there were contraptions of an extraordinary sort.
I did have a little inkling that there was something very dusty and very, that kept falling apart, that he was working on and that nobody knew about it. Actually, it was only, it just a passing remark of my mother's that she was trying to help him keep this together and put it together.
The work, called Étant donné, which means given in English, is an elaborate peep show of a nude, molded in plaster and pigskin. It was built in a small studio on the top floor of a New York apartment building, with elements collected over a long period by Duchamp and his wife Tini, who helped him to gather twigs and bricks for the construction. She was also with him on holiday in Spain when he came across the wooden doors, which he brought back to use as the facade. Duchamp worked in secret on the Étant donné for 20 years. In accordance with his wishes, it was only revealed to the public after his death.
Even then, at the time he died in 68, it came as a terrible shock, and it was very upsetting and very annoying to a lot of people, and particularly this work. which seemed to many people to be a denial and a contradiction of everything he'd done before.
Marcel Duchamp made his name when he launched a series of shocking and witty assaults on the art world. He turned his back on 500 years of Western culture in a dramatic subversion of existing definitions of art. He was the father of conceptual art and was mythologized in his lifetime as the 20th century rebel who had tried to destroy the word art altogether.
I don't care about the word art because it's been so discredited and so forth.
But you in fact contributed to the discrediting, didn't you? Quite deliberately.
Deliberately, yes. So I really want to get rid of it. There's a sort of unnecessary adoration of art today, which I find unnecessary. And I think, I don't know, but this is a difficult position because I've been in it all the time and still want to get rid of it, you see. And I cannot explain everything I do because I do things or people do things and don't know why they do it.
Duchamp was drawn to the art world as a child. He grew up in Normandy in northern France, the youngest son in a family of six children. His father was a local civil servant, his mother a withdrawn and distant figure in his otherwise happy childhood. He was introduced into the French art world by his older brothers Jacques and Raymond, one a painter, the other a distinguished sculptor. Marcel admired them both, and at a young age he had already decided to become an artist himself.
Well, this is the Becquerel, and it's a gas lamp, which he drew, which Duchamp drew when he was in school in the lycée in Rouen. And must have been 17, and it was a lamp fixture in his room. It must have kind of fascinated him, this image here of the gas light that came up. And he used it again in his very last piece, Étant donné.
Étant donné was the final stroke in a long career full of strange and startling works. But Duchamp's artistic journey started in a more traditional way. At first, he was a painter and embraced a variety of artistic styles, an inspired apprenticeship, which Duchamp later referred to as his swimming lessons.
Dove into one style for a short period of time and then swam out of it just as easily as he got in. And he's just in and out because he's just wetting his palate in a sense, and he becomes bored with the style almost as soon as he becomes proficient.
This restless exploration of styles and influences concluded with his cubist masterpiece, Nude Descending a Staircase.
His first famous work, the Nude Descending a Staircase, was looked upon at first by his fellow cubists as a send-up of cubism, because the cubists were very serious about their subject matter, and they certainly did not think that the nude was the subject for a cubist picture. And the idea of a nude descending a staircase like a showgirl in a Busby Berkeley musical struck a lot of them as a very offensive joke. And it was largely for that reason that he was asked to remove it from the Anne Depondo's exhibition to which he had submitted it. He was very offended, particularly because it was his two brothers who were also artists, who were delegated to come and ask him either to change the title or to remove it from the exhibition. And he chose to remove it, and he never took part in any of their group activities after that. His natural course was not to belong to groups. He was a loner.
No, I never enjoyed being a part of a group. I've always wanted to make something of personal contribution to it, which is only can only be done if you think by yourself and not follow the general rules of the group, you see.
Duchamp branched out on his own and came up with a revolutionary new kind of art which he called the ready-made. Everyday objects chosen by Duchamp and turned into works of art simply by adding his signature. From a snow shovel to a bicycle wheel, a glass bottle of Paris air to a defaced image of the Mona Lisa, his aim was to shock the public, outrage the art world, and mock the pretensions of the traditional artist.
You couldn't overlook a urinal on public display in an exhibition, because at that point you'd have to ask yourself, is this a work of art? You'd have to ask the central question that a ready-made forces you to ask. You could no longer just walk by it and pretend even to yourself that it wasn't art. Here it was, in the middle of an exhibition, treated as a work of art.
My idea was to choose an object that wouldn't attract me either by its beauty or by its ugliness, to find a point of indifference in my looking at it, see? Of course, you might say I'd find any number of those, but at the same time, it's not so much, because it's hard and difficult. After a while, when you look at something, it becomes very interesting. You can even like it. And the minute I liked it, I would discard it.
Duchamp's cultivation of cool indifference and his reluctance to engage with his fellow artists was also reflected in his personal life. The American artist Beatrice Wood experienced this when she met him in 1916.
He was very detached in the finest sense, but we were immediately clicked. Something was said about drawing, and I said, oh, I can't draw, there's no room in my mother's house. And he said, come to my studio and draw, which I did. And we had a wonderful friendship. He said, if I'm not in, I'll leave the key for you. And when you phone, if I'm busy, I'll tell you. But if you're not busy, you come. And of course, it meant when he was busy that he had some nice lady taking his time, because then our relationship was platonic. We had a wonderful friendship because I put no pressure on him. There was beautiful understanding. I let him completely free. And he helped me over my conventional stupidities, let's say. I made this nude. Marcel said, you have to put a soap on a tactical position, shop for it, and get the right color and right shape. So I did, and finally I got it, and he glued it on the painting. And there were very few ready-mades or things way out in those days. And at the exhibition, people would stand in front of it laughing due to Marcel, his mischief.
Eventually, their friendship developed into an affair, during which she was fascinated and frustrated in equal measure by his approach to their relationship.
With this beautiful expression he had of detachment, he was like a Zen priest. And he was very much like that. He was not given emotionally to anger or love. He said sex and love are two different things. He said all the time, cela n'a pas d'importance.
It's not important.
He said it continually, particularly if I was in any way emotional about either my relationship with him or someone else. It wasn't important, yes.
Duchamp's emotional detachment was a source of frustration to the many women who fell in love with him. The freedom of his single status was of huge importance to him, and for much of his life he was known as the King of the Bachelors. His inability to combine sexual and emotional involvement was a central theme in one of his most important works, a huge etching in glass, on which he worked painstakingly for 8 years, starting in 1915. Enigmatically named The Bride Stripped Bare by Her Bachelors, even, it is also known as The Large Glass. The bride of the title is represented in the upper half of the glass as a combination of abstract mechanical parts and a floating cloud. Below her, 9 equally abstract bachelors seek to be united with her, but are locked in an endless cycle of frustration.
The extraordinary thing about The Large Glass for me is that it is evident that he was trying to do something that was completely novel. It was as though it wasn't a question of doing something novel in that it was a different kind of story, a different kind of narrative, a different way of painting, but it's as though it's another kind of art. It's to say, if art didn't exist, what would art be like? And then starting from that far down. And during this process of starting from scratch, he even gets to the point of saying, we don't need eyes, you know, the retina is not the thing that makes artists. It's the mind that makes the artist.
The glass was broken in transit to an exhibition in 1926. How did you feel when it was broken?
Nothing, not much, at least. I was, I was not, because I'm fatalist, maybe, enough to take anything as it comes along. And fortunately, a little later, when I look at the breaks, I love the breaks. The breaks take a similar direction in the two panes. So when you put them on top of one another, they seem to continue the same breaks, as though I had it done it in purpose.
Marcel's place that he arrived at was so different that it's no surprise that it should be so little understood. I felt that he had spent his youth trying to get to a different place, something that would separate him from and free him from the pressures and the goings-on that people do in groups. So he ended up being a solitary researcher following this path that led him, among other places, to The Large Glass. I remember when he told me, we were talking about it, and I had already in my mind the image of this big plate of glass in his 14th Street studio. And he told me that as he was working on it, he said, you see, I mean, I wasn't working on a work of art. I was just making it because I wanted to make it. And partially it's true. He was simply making it because of his joy in putting together this strange story growing in him and becoming an answer to what he wanted to say.
Duchamp published a series of notes to accompany and explain the large glass. They are often as elusive as the work itself, but they offer clues about its personal significance to him.
And if you look at Duchamp's notes, there is a tiny little drawing of the large glass where you can see the bride just vaguely sketched at the top. And rather than write out the entire word marié, he writes M-A-R, period. And to define the bachelors below, there was very little space on the page, he writes C-E-L, and then the rest of the word célibataire. But of course, if you use the two abbreviations of marié and célibataire, you get mar-cel. So you could, I suppose, see the entire large glass as a kind of autobiographical machine, where Duchamp, in that context, represents the bachelor in quest of his bride. The theme of sexual frustration that is part and parcel of the large glass exists just as well in the Etant Donnée. In the case of the Etant Donnée, you are a bachelor standing on one side of the door. You're looking into these two little peepholes, and you cannot attain a full and satisfying view of this figure. The bachelor cannot attain full and satisfying union with his bride.
In 1927, Duchamp astonished his friends and colleagues when he announced that he had decided to get married. His bride was Lydie Sarrazin Levasseur, the daughter of a wealthy automobile manufacturer.
When Duchamp married for the first time, he made it a point to write to all of his friends to explain why he got married and what the context was. He didn't explain all of the details of it, but he made it clear that he married a woman who was completely independent financially. He wanted to make that clear to them that he had not entered into a union with someone in the traditional way where he would have to be obligated to her, and he wasn't on any level. She was wealthy enough and had her own income from her parents, and in fact the marriage didn't last but more than 6 months.
This about turn in his private life was matched by a rumor that he had given up art for good and taken up a new career.
He said his great ambition now was to become a professional chess player. He had played chess as a child, always loved it, and in the 20s, he really set out to become a master. He went into training, he began entering tournaments, he played against most of the greatest players of his era, and did surprisingly well for someone who took it up fairly late in life.
Okay. If I check there, you go back. Is that correct or not?
Check.
Yeah, he used to be a member here.
He used to live in this block, in the other side.
This is a famous block. And a number 50 was a meeting ground for famous artists.
He was a very important artist.
Oh, yeah, he was one of the great ones. But he loved chess more than anything. He was very addicted to chess. Yeah. But he used to love chess more than married life. You know what his wife did once? Have you no idea? She was so annoyed at his thinking of chess all the time that when he was sleeping, she took all his pieces and glued them down. You get it? She glued down the pieces on the while I couldn't play it.
A game of chess can be artistic. Decidedly, because it's a visual form of movements. The bishop takes the bishop, the pawn moves, and so forth. In other words, when you look at a game of chess, you don't look at a game of chess as a visual, static thing. There's nothing beautiful in the sight of a chess game in progress. But when you play the game, the different movements, the succession of different movements, has a beauty of its own.
On the outside of things, it did look as though he had not only abandoned painting, but his entire artistic career for another. I doubt very much that he was the creator of this myth, because he always said that he would continue to paint if he could come up with another idea for something new. He just was not interested in repeating himself and doing the same old thing over and over again just to become more and more famous and to become part of the system that made artists both rich and famous. He was seeking an alternative, but he never totally abandoned his interest in art.
During the next 20 years, Duchamp maintained his links with the art world through friends like fellow artist and chess player Man Ray. They appeared together in an early surrealist film. He also worked as an art dealer and was frequently invited to help in the organization of exhibitions. On one occasion, invited to create a provocative installation at a surrealist show, he festooned the gallery and all the work in it with a mild